The next module in this front end of the line process flow is the formation of junctions. So the next thing we need to do is form our source and drain junctions. And that typically involves implanting the species. So we want to implant dopants, and then we want to activate those dopants to form this source and drain junctions. So this implants, it consists of multiple species that are implanted, and each of them has a different purpose. So typically in any advanced transistor or any short channel transistor, you have three main implants. So the first one is a halo implant. So this is an implant which is of the same species as your substrate. So suppose you have a n-type substrate, so this is a n plus implant. That is, you do implant of the same species, and you do it at a side angle such that you essentially implant this region. And then the next implant is the source and drain extension implant. So this is the source and drain extension implant, and this is a relatively lower doping implant again, and it's of a different species. So this one would be a P implant. And then the final implant is your source drain, deep source drain implant. So your final implant is a deep source drain implant. And again, it's of the opposite species as the substrate, and it's of even higher doping. So this would be a P plus implant. So let's say you had an N-type substrate of, say, arsenic. So this halo implant would be a very high dose, low energy arsenic implant. And then your source drain extension would be a boron implant, and then your source drain would be another boron implant with a much higher dose and slightly higher energy. So the purpose of these halo and these source drain extensions, so the purpose of this halo implant and this source drain extension implant is to essentially minimize your short channel effects. And we will discuss how these help in minimizing the short channel effects in a later video. But right now, just assume that to minimize these short channel effects, we need this halo implant and we need this source drain extension implant. So how do we enable these different, implants? So the way it's actually done is that you first start with the wafer that you obtained after your gate patterning. So after your gate patterning, you had something like this. So you had your poly gate, which was patterned. And then you do your source drain extension implant. So this would be, in this case, would be a boron implant. And then you do your halo implant, and this halo implant is done at an angle. So it penetrates through through your gate and goes inside here and forms this halo region. And it's done at an angle, and you rotate your wafer while you're doing this implant. So this, your wafer would be inclined at this angle, and you'll be implanting your species from the top. At the same time, you'll keep on rotating this wafer, so you get implant species from here, and you also get implant species from here. And that helps you form this halo region. And once you have done your source drain extension implant and you have done your halo implant, you actually you form a spacer. So you form this nitride spacer, and then you implant your deeper and high energy or high dose source drain implant. So once you have formed this spacer, then you can essentially implant boron again, and that would go, that would be of a much higher dose, and it would be of slightly higher energy, and then you get this source drain implant. So let me show you in this in 3D. So let's say you had your You had these p-well and n-well regions, so you cover one of them, so you cover your p-well region, and then you do your source drain extension implant, so you implant this boron. So this is an n-well region, so you implant boron to form your source drain extension, and then you implant your arsenic at an angle. So this arsenic is implanted at an angle, let's say 30 degree angle, and this forms the halo region. So this forms this halo region over here. And then you cover, so right now we implanted the N-well, now we'll cover the N-well. So we cover the N-well with this photoresist, and now we implant our P-well. And again, first we want to form the source drain extension, so we can either implant arsenic or we can implant phosphorus. And then we want to form a halo for this, so we implant boron at an angle. So we implant boron at an angle, and again it forms these source and this it forms these halo regions as shown over here. And then the next step you do is form a spacer. So the way we form a spacer is you deposit a conformer film of nitride. So you deposit this silicon nitride film conformally throughout your wafer, so it covers the entire wafer. And then you do a RIE etch, or you do a dry etch. So you remove the nitride on the flat surface, but you leave the nitride on the sidewall. So you form this sidewall spacer of nitride. Once we have deposited this sidewall spacer, the next step is to do these deep source and drain implants. So again, we cover one type of transistors with the photoresist. So we cover the P-well with photoresist. And in the N-well, we implant it with the boron. And then we strip off that photoresist, and then you essentially cover with photoresist again, and then expose your other transistors, and in this case you then implant it with the arsenic. So now you have formed your, you have implanted your source drain regions, and you have finished all the implants. And the next step is to essentially anneal the implants. And the next step you want to do is do a high temperature step that will activate these dopants. And these anneal requirements are driven by actually the device requirements. So shown here is the ITRS roadmap. And what it dictates is that to control the short channel effects in your device, you are, as you are scaling your gate length, your gate oxide thickness, so you want to scale your junction depth as well. So it says that junction depth should keep on reducing every year. At the same time, it says that you want lower resistance also, because you don't want your transistor performance to be limited by your resistance from your source and drain. So you want to keep your source and drain resistance constant, or you want to reduce it. So it says that you want to reduce your source and drain extension. At the same time, you want to make it shallower. So these are opposing requirements. So you want to make a region with a very shallow depth. At the same time, you want it to have lower resistivity. So the only way you can achieve this is you want higher and higher doping concentration. So you want higher and higher concentration of your dopants. At the same time, you want them to be very shallow. So you want your junction depth to be very shallow. So this requires you know, your anneals to be done at much higher temperature, and you want them to be done at much shorter time. So if you look at the landscape of anneals that have been used in the semiconductor processing, so this is shown over here, they have been going up in temperature and they have been going down in time. So starting with the furnace anneal, where you would essentially just load up these wafers into a furnace and you let them anneal for hours. Then the next evolution of anneal was that you do this thing called RTA anneal, and then followed by this was, you know, followed by spike anneal, and then you now do millisecond anneals, and going forward people are even talking about doing microsecond anneals and nanosecond anneals. at the same time you start going from above in temperatures from 700 to 800 all the way to, you know, right now reaching the melting point of silicon. So this is depicted in this chart over here as well, which shows how your anneal time has been going from, you know, hours all the way in a furnace anneal to a RTP anneal where, or a spike anneal where they used to be in seconds, and going to flash anneal which does it in milliseconds, and all the way going to laser anneal which has a time scale of microseconds. And so it's actually quite a complicated problem, how to generate these temperatures in a very short time, and then how to cool it off in a millisecond time frame as well. We'll discuss this in a later video, but I just want to mention that this is how the anneal roadmap has been evolving, that you go in lower in time and higher in temperature. Note that the anneal step was where we encountered the highest temperature or the highest thermal budgets in the process flow. So we saw that, you know, we use temperature near above 1000 degrees centigrade to activate the implants. And then once we have activated our implants, we are done forming our junctions. The next step is to form contacts to these source and drain implants. So we employ a process which is called self-aligned silicide. So we need to form a contact or a silicide with our silicon, and the process which is employed is a self-aligned process to form this silicide, also known as salicide. So the way this works is you have formed your junctions now, and you also have the spacer material separating your gate and your source drain. And what you do is essentially you do a blanket deposition of nickel. So you deposit a blanket layer of nickel everywhere. So you have this nickel conformally covering your whole wafer. And then what you do is you do an anneal step. This is a low temperature anneal. In the anneal temperature of around 300 to 400 degrees centigrade. And what happens at that temperature is your nickel reacts with your silicon, and it forms this nickel monosilicide phase, which is a low resistivity phase. An important point is that, again, thermal budgets are important over here, so you don't want to go to higher temperature. So if you go to temperature which are high, it forms this nickel disilicide phase, which has a higher resistivity. So we want to make sure that the temperature in this step is stays between 300 to 400 kind of a range. And at this temperature, what happens is your nickel reacts with the silicon to form this nickel silicide. So this nickel silicide is shown over here in this dashed region. So this is where your nickel was exposed to silicon or polysilicon, and it formed this nickel silicide over here. On the sidewall, this nickel does not react with the nitride, so on the sidewall it remains in this nickel phase because it does not react with this nitride. So what you do next is, so you dip it, you do a wet etch, and you remove your unreacted nickel from the sidewall, and so this nickel is removed, and you are left with your reacted nickel which formed this nickel silicide. So you essentially now have your nickel silicide on top of your gate. You also have it on top of your source, on top of your drain. So using this spacer, we were able to obtain this self-alignment between the spacer. The spacer helped in forming these nickel silicide on the source and drain and the gate without them shorting each other. So that's why it's called a self-aligned process flow, because of the spacer which helps in forming all these silicide on the source and drain together without and the gate without shorting them. So the spacer not only helps in the implants where you want to form that soul drain extension, but it also helps in this silicide formation. And once we have formed the silicide, we essentially we are done with forming our transistors. So we now want to protect them and keep them safe. So we cover them with a layer of nitride, followed by a layer of oxide, and this is a conformal deposition. So it preserves the topography of your transistor. And next, you might want to polish them for further processing. So you do a CMP step, and now you have these nice transistors, nice little transistors, and they are covered with this oxide layer. And that essentially finishes our front end of the line process flow. And now, you know, you can kick the bucket down to the back end of the line to finish the rest of your microprocessor flow.